welcome to Decent Life. All you need is love. And I'm James Blair, filling in for Lou Pugliofito, and who is in the control room today. And I am delighted to introduce our guest today, Eliot Rabin, who is going to be the Republican candidate for the 12th Congressional District in the Upper East Side.
Hi, guys.
Welcome.
Thank you. Nice to be here.
Nice to meet you.
Pleasure.
Welcome. Now, the phone line will be open, and as a reminder, when you do get online, turn down your TV. Make sure that you listen only to your phone. Remember, there's going to be several second delay, and give your name and location. And so, let's get started. Well, you have an interesting background, Eliot. Tell us about yourself.
Well, I'm from Charleston, South Carolina, and I came to New York after being discharged from the Army in January of 1970.
So you served in Vietnam?
No, I didn't serve in Vietnam. I served in a secret place called the Czech border during Prague Spring.
Wow.
And I had lost three classmates in Vietnam, which brought me to New York from Charleston. I was kind of depressed.
Okay. What makes you run for office?
I'm tired, frankly, and I'll be frank. I think the country is in a moral abyss. I think we're morally bankrupt.
Yeah.
And I think that I have some ideas and some things to rebalance our society and to make the playing field a little bit more level between the so-called haves and have-nots.
Well, elaborate on that. What would you do as a congressman?
Well, I would bring back the draft, but not necessarily militarily.
Right.
I would bring it back so you could serve the country, like AmeriCorps, for example. But I would add two new branches to the service where you would all serve. And one would be the DPC, Domestic Peace Corps,
right,
defined by what it is. The second would be the YRC, the Youth Reaction Corps,
right,
also by definition. They would assist or become the first responders. And then immigrants. They would serve only in the military for 4 years.
Right.
Learn English, which I believe...
Starting age 18.
Starting at age 18.
Right.
And they would serve for 4 years only in the Army, only in the service, only in the military. Why?
Right.
They'd learn our language, a language that should be national by law, period. We are the only truly heterogeneous country in the world, and a commonality of purpose and language is what brings people
You're
together.
You're talking the peacetime Army, then?
Yes, I'm talking about Army peacetime or wartime. Right. And at the end of the 4 years, the immigrants then, automatically, they wouldn't serve for two, they serve four. At the end of four, they and their families get automatic citizenship.
Would you be open to a Peace Corps-like situation where people can, say, work in public service?
That's the idea.
So
that's the idea. You go to Appalachia, you try to start to take an issue that we have in this country called obesity,
right,
and teach people proper nutrition, proper health, proper way to take care of the home, and proper way to speak to one another on a playing field that has some manners, some civility.
So would you consider this similar to perhaps the Roosevelt era, the Civilian Conservation Corps of the 1930s?
Yes, I would, because my dad was actually served in Roosevelt's Works Progress Administration,
right,
many years ago.
So what other issues are at the top of your list?
Well, as we just mentioned, socio-divisiveness. I believe education.
Right.
I believe when you take away cursive writing from schools, you're doing the students in this country an incredible injustice, because it's not just about the reading.
Right.
It's the hand, eye, brain, coordination, and it's a discipline. I'll venture to say that most of the students in our country today cannot read the Declaration of Independence in its original form.
What about crucial issues like being able to read and write and math and basic skills?
Well, what's wrong with the three R's? It's been there for 5,000. By the way, now that you mention that,
right,
the three R's, reading, writing, spelling, arithmetic,
right,
the National Spelling Bees, 10 finalists,
right,
were all Asian American. I wonder why.
Right.
They sit at a table with their families, not with a phone. Okay? I happen to think, as wonderful as all this communication is, it is detrimental to the brains of our children. I try to teach my son. I'm 76 years old with a 16-year-old boy. And the first thing I try to stress to him is first this, then this. Not this, and then that. This doesn't get hacked, whacked, smacked, and jacked. This does.
Well, you mentioned about other issues about Republicans and Democrats, how they get along today. So what's on your mind about that?
The other night, I understand that the Republican headquarters on East 83rd Street in Manhattan was vandalized, but I forgot the name of the folks, some kind of fascist group.
Yeah.
Okay. But you know what? You can attribute to both sides. And when you have leaders on left, right, liberal, conservative, Democrat, Republican, et cetera, that are setting a poor example.
Right. I might add, what happened is that the vandals spray painted the letter A on the brownstone building, threw a rock or brick, broke a building, and then put glue on the rocks, on the locks, and so it was an ugly.
Not a nice situation.
Right.
And that's what I mean by civility. If you look at my hashtag, they wanted me to say something like Maloney is baloney. No.
Right.
I'm not attacking. Our hashtag is tolerance is the key.
Right.
Civility. Civility is the lock.
Well, the question that's raised, there's no condoning such criminal acts, and that's what it is. But what are our politicians in both parties doing that are polarizing our country and creating this tribalism and hatred, which is so beyond what it ever was decades ago?
Well, I'm not going to mention names, but when you have one person say it's okay to go harass someone in a restaurant, you know, you may have 1,000 people that hear harassment.
Right.
But you may have one of those 1,000 hear something a lot worse.
Right.
Okay? And you have it on both sides. I don't believe that the president of our country should be attacking any individual whatsoever, whether they're good, bad, or indifferent. I think some of his policies are absolutely terrific, but I think you can achieve these policies by being civil and by being tolerant.
Well, you can't run for office, a federal office, without the elephant in the room, which is the president. What are your thoughts about this? Do you distance yourself from him, or do you agree with some of his positions?
I agree with some of his positions. I do not agree with his approach.
For example, what approach bothers you? Like, he calls the press the enemy of the people.
Well, the press is not the enemy of the people. And he just said yesterday, given the fact that what's happened to Mr. Khashoggi out of the Saudi Arabian journalist,
right.
He actually said, the president said, it's a horrible thing that this was done to a reporter.
Right.
And he actually said, I'm sure you're surprised to hear me say that.
Well, excuse me.
We do have a caller coming in. Yes.
Hello, you're on the air. Hello.
Hi.
Hi. You have a question for us?
Yes. My name is Larry, and I live on the Upper East Side. I think I have to turn down my volume. So.
Yeah, because you do get feedback.
Welcome, Larry.
Okay.
What was your question?
Congressional elections are every 2 years, which I think is a good thing, because one of the things that I feel about Carolyn Maloney is she's been in too long and that we need change.
Carolyn Maloney, of course, being the current incumbent in the 12th
district. Right, she's the incumbent and she is running on the Democratic side.
Right.
And I am a Democrat and I'm interested in change and I'm interested in what Mr. Rabin had to say about civility and common sense, both of which are very important, I think, in politics today. One of the things that I'm interested in is his position on the fact that he's a Republican, because a lot of people in my area, the Upper East Side, will just simply pull the lever for the Democrats. And the fact that he is a Republican and what's going on in Washington with the Trump administration will make people reluctant to vote for a Republican.
Okay, well,
thank you. I'm interested in his independence,
right?
In his common sense approach. I'm interested in change. I know he's Mr. Rabin, because I live in the neighborhood, is a small business.
That's great, but what's the one particular question that we want to get at? Because you covered a lot.
Well, I'm interested in his feelings on civility. I see he has his civil hat sitting in front of him. I know he's got a military background.
Okay.
Let me answer that.
Okay, thanks, Larry.
Let me answer that.
Thank you, Larry.
When folks come into my shop, they say to me...
When you say, by the way, tell them what your shop is.
I own a shop by the name of Peter Elliot, have for 41 years, and one of the things that got me going was taxes in the city, but that's a local issue. People say to me, are you a Democrat or Republican? And I have to answer Republican because I'm on their ticket. Do I have to? No, I don't. I sort of answer them by this. I say, I am a member of my own party. It's called the CSP party, the Common Sense Party, because common sense makes sense. Civility is a key to life. Years and years and years ago, we had something called a civil war. We have another one, but today it's a cold civil war. And some of the incidents that occurred the other night at the Republican headquarters, the local headquarters, can incite things like a hot civil war. And we hope and we know, with common sense being the objective of all of us, that won't happen.
Well, let me ask you this, in all fairness, the group responsible, or Antifa, which is an extreme right-winger, not fair to associate all Democrats anymore with extremists for Republicans. But the question is, as a congressman dealing with a highly charged atmosphere in Washington, especially with the Kavanaugh confirmation, what are you going to do differently as a Republican in terms of getting along with Democrats and changing the tone?
I'm going to stand up before the Congress and say what I feel in my heart.
Right.
And that you folks are morally bankrupt. You have no moral courage. You're all about party and not about people.
Are you saying all 435?
I am saying not all 435. Right. I am saying there's a couple of guys. I wish I could. Tim Scott is one from South Carolina.
Right. Right.
Nikki Haley is another fantastic
Tim
person.
Tim Scott, the senator from South Carolina.
Okay.
Nikki Haley just resigned from the UN.
Correct.
Okay.
Now, there's a couple of guys, some of them ex-Special Forces, some of them ex-Navy SEALs, that are now Republican, are now congressmen.
Right.
Both military. And I sincerely believe that this is something that we have to look at really, really close. Not that all military people are terrific and patriotic, but we need more patriotism. Right. We need the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag, okay?
Okay.
Period.
So let me ask,
these are good traditions, not bad traditions.
So let me ask you this. There are factions in the Republican Party. It is not a monolith. There is the more moderates who probably are in trouble in the coming election.
Correct.
And then there are, of course, the Freedom Caucus, who are the extremists. Where do you see yourself, and if you are moderate, do you speak up to the Freedom Caucus?
I speak to anything an issue. I speak to issues that really are common sense issues. I speak to issues like, it's very simple. Let's talk about guns.
Right.
All right? Freedom Caucus is this caucus.
Sure.
The Second Amendment, in my opinion, and I'm not a lawyer, and I'm certainly not a constitutional lawyer,
sure,
but when I read the Second Amendment, I seem to see that stands out in my eyes and in my mind, organized militia.
Right.
Organized militia. Okay? Let's go back. It took 30 seconds, 20, 30 seconds to load a musket back then.
Right.
And you were lucky if you could hit the broadside of a barn at 20 yards.
We have another call coming in.
We have another call, yes.
Hello?
Hi, my name is Francesca.
Welcome.
Thank you. And could you please tell us a little bit more about what you think about the Me Too movement and how you stand, what's your position on that?
Yes, go ahead.
Well,
thank you for the question.
Thank you.
Y'all may laugh about this one, but I always wonder what would have happened if that Harvey Weinstein would have looked like George Clooney. I think you might have a little bit of different conversation about it. I'm not saying it shouldn't happen. In fact, I got a call a couple of weeks ago from an old friend of mine that I may want to introduce you to, young fellow, and said to me, do you know that you were a pioneer in what we now call the Me Too movement? When my boss bit me on the boob and you called a lawyer immediately and you got a big settlement almost at once? Well, the Me Too movement, I think the time is ripe. I think it's a fantastic thing. I can speak factually that women are not paid equally as men for doing the same job. I've seen it in my career in my business. Doesn't happen in my business. Happens on Wall Street as we speak. So Me Too, I would call the Me Too movement a Me Too movement, but not just about women.
What do you draw the line?
About us too.
Okay. Our politicians, our judges should be held accountable for these actions. You agree with
Without
that?
A doubt.
Okay.
I'll tell you something.
Well, let me ask you this. You can't talk about this without talking, of course, about the recent Supreme Court, Brett Kavanaugh. What, you have any comment about that?
Yes, I do.
Yes.
When you are in the service, and when you went to the school that you learn about body language.
Okay.
Okay? I think that the doctor was incredibly virtuous. I think that the doctor was incredibly believable.
Right.
And I think that a judge, to get emotional like he did, says something. Now, do I know who is accurate, who is veritable, who is telling the truth, who was not?
Right.
No, I don't know. But I'm going to jump back just a little bit.
Sure.
When Donald Trump had a child in 2006 and the next day, he did what he did, and I don't need to mention all these names, Stormy, Formy, and all that stuff.
Stormy Daniels,
I thought that defined him morally. All right? And I think that as you go forward, you have a lot of, and I'm an old white man, okay?
Well, not so old, okay?
Well.
By the way, you're
age-wise, yeah. I am. Yeah. Mind-wise, I'm not, okay? I just feel that these things that we are talking about right now all evolve around the single thing of tolerance and civility, the ability to speak to one another, the ability, look, we're not equal.
Let me ask you that point blank. If you don't answer, understand. If you were a senator, what would you have done?
In regards to?
Kavanaugh. Of course, it's the Senate that votes on this, but...
All right, I will answer you.
Right.
I will answer you.
Right.
Given all the information that was at the hands that they had, given the cards that they were dealt.
Right.
What's the name of the congressman, Ms. Collins?
Susan Collins. Senator from Maine. Yes.
Correct.
Right.
I thought when she spoke after the fact and before the fact that I would have probably gone along with her. But not being there, I don't know.
Right. To clarify, Senator Collins had voted, as a moderate Republican who voted in favor of the confirmation, to sum up a 40-minute speech. It was that in a court of law, he hasn't been convicted. Well, I guess there's another issue. Well, look, it goes around saying who approves of this sexual assault, but there's another issue with Kavanaugh, which is that in 1998 or so, he was part of the Starr Commission, which was investigating the impeachment with Clinton and highly charged, and then he worked for the Bush administration, and then he was part of the Gore-Bush recount in 2000. Is this not a partisan man? Is this really who we should be putting on the court?
My knowledge of that is limited.
Okay.
But I will say to you, from what I've heard, from what I read, from what I see, and remember, he was the clerk for an incredibly fair-minded justice.
Right.
And hopefully, he'll use that going forward as an example as he goes forward.
Are there limits to how partisan a man should be? I mean, he worked for...
I think that the Supreme Court of the United States should be the most nonpartisan organization in the world.
So, fast answer, would you have voted for him or not on this count?
No.
Okay, fair enough. Let's move on to other issues.
I do have since this is a Democratic state, what's his feelings on immigration?
Okay, ready? All of us are immigrants, okay?
Right.
I don't believe, first of all, the wall is not just a wall. It impacts, guess what? It impacts wildlife.
The Mexican wall.
Correct. It impacts wildlife. And if you read anything about the defenders of wildlife, they have a huge issue with the wall, okay?
Right.
Huge issue. I think that people need to follow the rules. And I think that the Democrats, please excuse me, downplay MS-13. It is
the criminal
organization.
Right, right.
And downplay the fact that your tax base, your infrastructure, cannot continue to support, tax-wise and otherwise, illegal immigrants coming.
All right.
All
right, let me ask you this. It's just understood that no Democrat wants criminals in here either. The question is, what do you do about the millions of people who are not part of a criminal gang? What kind of rights?
Well, part of my answer was done before when I said bring back the draft. You put them in the military and let them earn their citizenship in a
40-year-old person who's working as a nanny? Well, you can't.
You go. This is the old story. Who cuts the grass?
Who's going to pay for this?
Who cuts the grass? It's the same thing.
Right.
Who pays for it? You're paying for it. I'm paying for it. So somewhere along the line.
Okay, so the implication is that you're going to take 10 million people, maybe half of them you put into this modern Peace Corps you have in mind.
Great.
And who are you willing as a Republican to raise taxes $10, $20, $30 billion or to pay for this? Because it costs money.
I don't know. Right. I'm not so familiar with this issue.
Right.
We all have, the Congress is obviously, the current Congress is not obviously not familiar enough with this issue to solve the real problem.
Let's move on. Big issue, the stock market taking a dive this week. What do you have to say about the president's approach with Chinese tariffs?
I think the Chinese have been stealing intellectual property for years and years.
Okay.
I think there's an unfair trade practice as far as I understand it, that you are required for a Chinese national company to own 50% of an American company.
What about the replacement of NAFTA with the new United States Mexico-Canadian?
Okay, I think that the Canadian government also was at fault charging you 20 to 30% on certain goods, particularly milk. coming into their country.
All right, but let me ask you this. The president has been taking such a high charge on Canada and Mexico and our allies in the European Union. When China is the problem, I mean, you have something you say, is there some truth to that? Why not work with our friends and our allies instead of making
the trouble? Marshall Plan was 70 years ago.
The 19 late 40s, okay.
The Marshall Plan was right. When after World War II we saved Europe. I think everything has a lot of validity.
Right.
I'm not going to say to you that I have knowledge subjectively. My knowledge is basically objective.
But do you agree with the idea that we should focus our energy on China and not on our allies who fought with us, by the way, in World War II?
Okay, when you say allies, what do you mean allies as far as trade is concerned? Allies as far as NATO?
The democracies there are staunch allies, and he's going after them, talking about disrupting NATO. Why not work with them?
Well, I'm going to tell you straight up that when I was stationed in Germany, they did not pay their fair share. When we tore up their highways with our M60 tanks, okay, we had to reimburse them.
Let's move on.
Let's go, because I get passionate about that stuff.
Oh, everyone. What do you have to say about the president's renunciation of the Paris Protocol?
I think that is a huge mistake.
Okay, so you go against the Republican Party. Then.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely. I have a home that I've watched the water come up in well over a foot in 10 years.
Exactly. And your own hometown of Charleston is already having serious flooding. Speaking of treaties, what do you also have to say about the Iran treaty? What the president's doing with that?
I think he did the right thing.
Right.
All right, and I'll tell you why. I don't think you can be so subjective to say, okay, no nuclear weapons. There's a whole lot of peripheral items that need to be taken into consideration.
Like terrorism, like support of Hamas, like being involved with Syria and the
about
Yemen.
Threatening a country with absolute destruction.
Okay. In arguendo, if the idea is that Iran is up to a lot of bad things, death to Israel, death to America, but what about the harm to American reputation that we sign a treaty and then a year later or two later we back out? I mean, are there things to be said? For example, the SALT treaties of the 1970s, there was a SALT 1, there was a SALT 2 in the 1980s.
All the SALT agreements.
You fix one problem, you have another treaty to fix the second, another treaty. Instead of the president saying, let's now build on this, let's fix the problems, he simply abrogates the whole thing and disturbs the process and risks Iran having maybe nuclear weapons.
What's your response? Well, my response to that is I totally agree. SALT 1, SALT 2, SALT 3, terrific. They all built upon one another.
Okay, as a congressman, are you...
But...
Yeah.
There was no, if you really read the treaty,
sure,
the Iran treaty, there was no 100% verifiable inspection.
Then build on it. Have a second treaty.
How do you do that when they continue to refuse? You can't come here. You cannot look at this.
Are you willing as a congressman to go into the Oval Office and speak your mind to the president and disagree?
Without a doubt.
Are you willing to go to Ryan or the next House Speaker or Minority Leader?
Oh, if I get elected, I got
so
a big speech. Without a doubt.
Very good. All right, so let's move on. Affordable Care Act, Republicans tried several times earlier in the year to repeal. What's your opinion about that?
I don't have enough knowledge to really speak about it, but I'll say this.
Yeah.
A little bit of a tributary there. Don't you dare say to me that Social Security is an entitlement. It's a savings account that we've been putting away for years and years and since 17 or 18
years
old.
Let's focus on Affordable Care. Social Security is a different issue. Do you agree with the premise that the Affordable Care Act should provide health care to all citizens? Or
I don't know enough about the specifics of the Affordable Care Act, but I do feel that every American is entitled to health care from birth to death.
Okay.
Right. And let's just go back to that point. You're correct. Social Security is not an entitlement. We are paying into it, and we expect it to have it when we retire.
The Congress has been borrowing your Social Security for years, okay? It's time to stop. And don't you dare say to me, all right, that's an entitlement. It is a savings account, period. And by the way, you guys, when you get to be my age, you can feel the same way.
You are in favor, then, of Social Security remaining and untouched?
Absolutely.
All right. Now, apparently the demographics suggest that the country is going to have more and more older people.
That's correct.
To it. Are you prepared as a Republican to say we can't have $2 trillion, $3 trillion debts. We have to somehow raise taxes in order to support this program. What's your position on this?
I think we have such a bloated bureaucracy that there's a whole bunch of money in there.
The bureaucracy only accounts for 30%. Almost 70% is non-discretionary, which Congress can't control by statute unless they change the laws.
Correct. Well, then change the law.
You're willing to raise taxes to support this?
I am willing to raise taxes where it needs to be raised. I'll give you the game. Okay.
Okay.
I am a great believer. All right. that people who are taking people who are taking home net $1 million a year after tax should not get Social Security, should give it back, number one. Number two, people that have so much money in this country should be taxed accordingly.
We haven't got much time left. Are you willing to raise taxes on people with over half a million or $1 million income in order to support this?
Well, in Manhattan, particularly in New York State, a half a million dollars with a family is not a whole lot of money here.
Okay, well, we're starting to run out of time. So let's give you a couple of minutes. This is on your dime.
My dime.
And so why should people vote for you? Why should Democrats cross party lines and vote for you? Go ahead.
I don't want to be judged on parties.
Right.
I think that George Washington said that parties are the dearth of democracy.
Okay.
I want to be judged on where I speak from, my heart. I want to be judged as a citizen of my country that's a heterogeneous country, that is a country that speaks many languages, but a country that needs to come together as one language. And I think that I can do or add to those type of people that'll roll with us, myself, my campaign manager, Brian, whose Chinese family came here and built the railroads across this country. He's my campaign manager.
Okay.
And between he and I, we can do a whole lot of good.
One last question, we have another minute left. Gun control. The Republican Party is notorious for supporting gun rights, Second Amendment. What do you have to say about semi-automatics?
I love guns.
You love guns?
I collect guns.
Okay.
I totally disagree with the NRA's policy.
Are you a member of the NRA?
Absolutely not.
Okay.
And I've been asked many times, and I've said many times, no.
Then what do you have to say about people's rights to have assault weapons and clips?
First of all, an assault weapon called an AR-15 is not an assault weapon.
Right. Excuse me, but Elliot,
yes,
thank
sir.
You for being on. James,
thank you very much.
Thanks for hosting.
We ran out of time. It's a delight talking to you.
Well, let's do it again.
All the best. And